The supermarkets know exactly what we think. They know that we want our children's food to be nutritious and unadulterated by chemicals.
Yay! Good tomatoes, aren't they?
They know that we care about the environment and we're against waste. And they know that we want animals to be reared and killed humanely. There are millions of us that think like this, and the supermarkets want to convince us that they give us exactly what we want. But do they? Ago, we bought all our food from specialist high street shops. We knew our shopkeepers and they knew us, even if the greengrocer still passed off the occasional rotten apple. Even our milk and bread was delivered daily by the local dairy. But back in the 1950s, shopping started to change.
The supermarket and the self-service centre have come to stay. Already, there are over 4,000 in Britain.
It was the start of a retailing revolution. Today, the big four, Tesco, Sainsbury's, Asda and Morrisons, dominate UK food production and food retailing. And they persuade us they're giving us what we want by using health-conscious celebrities like Jamie Oliver.
The British asparagus season's pretty short, so make the most of it. And Sainsbury's get them in the store really quickly, so you don't lose any of that fantastic flavour. Easy.
The supermarkets do such amazing monitoring of what customers are thinking or asking. They do tracking surveys, all of them. Go and ask them. They all do tracking surveys. They don't release them, but they'll track what consumers are thinking on 30, 40, 50 different criteria about food.
And tracking surveys aren't the only thing they keep under wraps. Despite repeated requests for cooperation, none of the big four would allow us to film inside their stores. Are there things they'd rather we didn't know? Factory farming is a big issue for some consumers, and that's a commercial opportunity for the supermarkets. Now they can sell us more and more free-range organic poultry, even if it does cost more. Tonight, we thought we'd try duck, just for a change. But believe me, it's not the cheap option. These four duck breasts from Asda cost £8.40. And before making this programme, it never really occurred to me that ducks might be factory farmed too. From what I've learned, I'm beginning to doubt my choice. Ducks enjoying their natural habitat. Swimming is part of their genetic makeup, and in the wild, they spend up to 80% of their time in water. These ducks had a lucky escape. As ducklings, they were liberated from a Norfolk factory farm. Now they live here at the Hillside Animal Sanctuary near Norwich. Thousands of other birds were not so fortunate. Buried away in the Norfolk countryside lies this anonymous-looking poultry farm. It's owned by Kerry Foods. They supply duck to many British supermarkets, including the Big Four, and the market for duck is growing fast. In February 2003, investigators from Hillside Animal Sanctuary secretly shot this footage. This is a Kerry Foods packaging plant. The duck farm is just down the road. Inside the broiler shed, there were dead and suffering ducks.
This is the third dead duck. Duck number six is over here. Duck number seven is over here. Another duck on its back here.
At the time, the farm was accredited by the RSPCA's Freedom Food Scheme. This means it had been assessed to see if it met strict animal welfare standards. One is that livestock should have freedom to express normal behaviour. But here, as in the vast majority of British intensive duck farms, there's no water for swimming.
If you're setting standards for the keeping of ducks, then one of the conditions should be that the birds have access to an area of water in which they can swim. All ducks ought to be provided with water in which they can swim. And if you don't do that, then you're not caring for them adequately.
Duck number 14, I haven't seen him.
The RSPCA's Freedom Food Scheme also says livestock should have freedom from pain, injury and disease. Yet some of these birds are suffering from septicemia, a bacterial stress-related condition.
Septicemia can come on over a period of a few days, and clearly some of those birds were in a rather extreme state where they would have been suffering a lot from the disease.
Outbreaks of disease are commonplace in intensive poultry farms. Under the government code of practice, the birds should be systematically checked at least twice each day.
Those checks really need to be sufficient to pick out the bird which is in a bad way, the bird which needs to be taken out or the bird which needs to be humanely killed.
As soon as they discovered that the farm was accredited by the Freedom Food Scheme, Hillside investigators alerted the RSPCA. They immediately suspended the farm from their scheme, and Kerry Foods were prosecuted for causing unnecessary suffering to ducks. In their defence, Kerry Foods denied the charges in their entirety, maintaining that the birds had been properly checked by an experienced stockman. But because the footage had been obtained by trespass, the judge never saw this film, and she concluded,
there can be no doubt that this company did have the birds' welfare in mind.
And Kerry Foods were found not guilty. So, did things improve at the Kerry Foods farm? Last July, investigators from Viva, another animal welfare group, secretly filmed there too.
Here we've got two dead birds near a feeder. Got another duck here, looks like it's trapped. Been here for a while. This duck hasn't looked too well. This bird is dying.
In the later visits, there were still birds which were sick. There were birds which may well have had the same disease condition, and there were quite a lot of birds which died. You would expect there to be some birds which die, but it would appear that there's still quite a significant problem if there were quite a few birds which were dead or dying on any given day when a visit was made.
We wrote to Kerry Foods about the conditions on their farm, and they gave us this statement.
The farm operates to the highest industry standards, and the company's trained stockmen and veterinarians uphold the highest husbandry and industry standards.
As Kerry Foods supply duck to all the big four, we also asked the Supermarkets Trade Association, the British Retail Consortium, to comment on the welfare concerns raised by the undercover footage. They said,
supermarkets take the issue of animal welfare very seriously. It is a fundamental requirement of their suppliers. Any breaches in these standards are unacceptable and are always taken up with the producer.
I know that there are supermarket standards. Clearly, these should be enforced in such a way that we, first of all, make sure that the basic conditions are good enough and the needs are met, and secondly, that if there is a disease condition, that it's dealt with in a proper way so that there is a minimal amount of poor welfare in the animals.
And in case you're wondering, the RSPCA tells us that there are currently no British duck farms with Freedom Food accreditation. It's the big come-on. Rows and rows of perfectly presented fruit and vegetables. A glistening array designed to entice us through the doors. And it's always the first aisle you come to.
Supermarket buyers have become obsessed with cosmetic standards.
You walk into the store and you think, wow, this is lovely, lovely fresh fruits and vegetables. It creates a good impression, like flowers do.
We're presented with everything absolutely homogenous, perfect, uniform, so that it looks as though it's emerged from a lab. To be honest, it doesn't look normal.
You think, this is a nice place to shop. And it creates the idea that everything under the roof is fresh and wholesome and delicious.
But how does our food get to look that good? The answer lies in places like this. It's got to be perfect. It's got to be worth it to me. This is a supermarket packing house. Every day, a ruthless beauty contest roots out the less than perfect, even for your common or garden spud. After a quick scrub up, the first hurdle. Size matters. Too small, and they just fall through the holes. Next, it's shape. Any shape you like, as long as it's oval. For those that make it through, it's time to face the cameras. Anything with a blemished skin will be weeded out. In the end, only the best-looking potatoes make it. Just like life, really. And spuds are not alone. Every day, as much as 30% of perfectly edible produce will be rejected at supermarket packing sheds, just on the basis of appearance. Supermarket waste is not confined to Britain. We've managed to export it.
I've been to parts of the world where people are actually hungry, like Africa, where women are standing in huts measuring green beans because they're only allowed to be a very specific length and a very specific diameter. And anything that doesn't fit that absolutely perfect, straight blueprint gets chucked away. So it's been like a third of the beans in Kenya that I was watching being harvested were being thrown away, going to waste, because they didn't meet this extraordinary specification.
And supermarket specifications are indeed extraordinary. Earlier this year, The Guardian obtained one for cucumbers. According to the report, they must be between 10 and 13 inches long, must be evenly swollen along the length, and they must not have droop. And as for bulbous ends, well, they're simply not acceptable. And it's the same story with apples. This Kent farm supplies fruit to many of the big supermarkets. Today, the farm's apple sorting machine is grading cooking apples according to the supermarket's specifications. As usual, it's size, shape, colour and general appearance.
The standards for cooking apples are not as high as they are for eating apples, but that's a defect there and there. And it's picking up probably some bruising on this one there, and then some other defects as well. It's got to be.
The Griefer machine was developed from Israeli fighter aircraft technology, and even cooking apples get supermodel treatment. Each and every one is photographed by computerised infrared cameras.
The magic box behind this computer is taking 72 pictures of every apple, and what's coming up on the screen is all the defects that we've told it to learn. So it is a very, very clever bit of kit.
Clive Baxter reckons he loses about one-third of his crop because supermarket specifications are so rigid. But the supermarkets insist they do everything possible to reduce waste.
What they mean is no waste outside their backyard. The waste is happening elsewhere. When they reject a field of cauliflowers for having a bit of cosmetic damage to it, or not being the right size, or reject apples for not being the right size, or the look, or a bit of blemish. What does the farmer do with that? Eat it? They can't, they're fields. Throw it away? That's what happens. So there's hidden waste.
But is this hidden waste the consumer's fault? The supermarkets say they have to reject produce because we refuse to buy anything that's less than perfect.
I don't think consumers are driving this one bit. I don't think we've ever said, no, we must all have identical fruit. I don't think women go home at night in tears and say, my oranges are not identical.
The supermarkets can be sometimes falsely criticised for having created this cosmetically pretty-looking food, as though somehow consumers didn't demand that. Supermarkets, for example, did listen to consumers saying they didn't want earwigs coming out of cauliflowers, apples that had cracks in them. The problem is the hurdle has been set so high, inappropriately high, and it's now in a vicious circle of repeating itself.
So how do farmers achieve the exacting standards demanded by their supermarket customers? The answer is pesticides.
If you want pears that have got absolutely no blemishes on the skin, the farmer's going to have to use certain types of chemicals at certain points in the year to make sure that happens. And the legacy of that is obviously that we end up with residues in our food. I've talked to farmers who say, if I've got one aphid on my lettuce, my whole crate will be rejected. So, of course, I double the amount of spray I use to make sure there's absolutely no life left on it.
The supermarkets know that consumers worry about pesticide residues and claim they go to great lengths to encourage suppliers to minimise pesticides use.
Supermarkets love to get good PR out of trumpeting how they are reducing pesticides. But at one level they're saying, no, we are telling our growers to reduce pesticides. On the other side, they're delivering ridiculously tight standards, which any professional grower could tell you means you must use quite a substantial number of pesticides. So I think that it is totally hypocritical, the supermarket stance on pesticides. It just doesn't add up.
Government checks show that 30% of supermarket fresh fruit and vegetables do contain some pesticide residues. These are within the legal limits, but we've discovered something of potential concern to parents of babies and toddlers. Back in 1999, the EU issued a directive which massively reduced the amounts of pesticide residues allowed in processed baby foods to just 10 parts per billion.
The reason why the very low level has been imposed for prepared baby foods is on a precautionary basis, because children who are developing their brains, their immune system, their reproductive system are more vulnerable to the effect of things like hormone disruption.
This is news to me, and it's worrying. New mothers are advised by the NHS to wean their babies on fresh fruit and vegetables. So when I give Grace pureed fresh fruit, I assume it's better for her than what's in these bottled baby jars. But maybe cosmetically perfect supermarket produce is not as pure as it looks. Okay, so that's the last of the big four. So I've stocked up on the kind of fruit and veg that mums commonly like to give their young children and babies. But I'm not going to take this lot home. I'm off to the lab. This is Kent Scientific Services in Maidstone. We asked their analysts to use the government's own testing procedure to tell us how much pesticide residue was in our supermarket fruit and veg. In all, they tested 16 samples of produce, and they found pesticide residues in 7 of them. The good news is they were all under the government's limits. The bad news is they all exceeded the levels allowed in processed baby food. One sample contained 33 times as much. According to the government's Food Standards Agency, home-prepared baby foods could contain residues at a slightly higher level than would be found in manufactured foods. They maintain the risk is not significantly higher, but others disagree.
I think it is illogical that if you go and buy a prepared baby food, it's controlled by EU legislation, whereas if you go and buy fresh fruit from the supermarkets, they may well have levels of pesticide considerably higher. And that's an anomaly which I think the government has to address. We should be aiming for the same standard in fresh fruit, because we want to be able to feed our children fresh fruit. That's a very good thing to do.
In part two, more supermarket secrets. Buy one, get one free. Who pays? Factory-farmed cows. And the bouncing strawberry. In recent years, as concern about pesticide residues has grown, supermarkets have been quick to jump on the organic bandwagon.
It's much harder to get things looking that kind of beauty pageant perfect that the supermarkets expect if you don't use pesticides. And the irony is that although supermarkets now stock quite a lot of fruit and vegetables that is organic, they really apply the same cosmetic standards. It has to look as perfect as the conventional stuff.
South Wales farmer Bruce Carlyle grows organic potatoes for supermarkets. These won't be harvested until the autumn. But this lot, 15% of last year's crop, has been left to rot. They didn't meet the supermarket specification, so Bruce didn't even bother to send them to the packing plant.
They would say, right, these are not good enough, take them back. That potato, which is actually a misshape, now that will get rejected as a misshape. That potato has got something which is called netting. It's a rough skin finish. Now that, to me, is a perfect potato to be consumed, but is rejected on skin finish. That's a potato which is a perfect potato to look at, except if you've got a blemish, a growth crack on the end. It could be bruising, but it'll peel off.
Of the potatoes Bruce did send to the supermarket packing plant, another 25% were rejected. The Soil Association says organic farmers commonly have 40% of their crop wasted, purely on cosmetic grounds. And guess who picks up the tab for all this waste? The supermarkets? Wrong. It's the farmer.
If our potatoes get rejected, that's our waste, that's our loss. You get used to wastage, which I don't think is right. You get used to seeing 26 loads of potatoes not thrown back in your face, but returned to you because they're not good enough. It's soul-destroying. You know, it just doesn't go with organic farming.
And with so much waste, it's little wonder organic produce costs a bomb.
If the supermarket standards weren't so tight and so cosmetically correct, we would be producing produce at a much lower cost to the consumer and much less wastage.
So the consumer loses out, the farmer loses out, but at least Bruce Carlyle's cows are benefiting. He's fed 100 tonnes of last year's crop to his cattle, and they don't seem to care how ugly the potatoes are. British farming is in deep trouble. First there was BSE, then foot and mouth. And now, with supermarkets dictating that food either looks good or gets chucked away, farmers are being squeezed till they squeak. And what's bad for them is bad for us too.
Sometimes I scratch what hair I've got left, and I say, do consumers really understand that food comes from farmers? But equally, sometimes I look at farming and think, what on earth are they doing? Why would anyone farm?
Supermarkets are now so powerful, they've emerged as these incredible oligopolies who can dictate the price they pay. And they've sort of wiped out any other outlets. There are no real wholesale markets where farmers can say, OK, if you're not going to pay me properly, I'll take my goods somewhere else, because somewhere else doesn't actually exist anymore.
And you see an extraordinary thing going on in British farming, the collapse of profitability in farming, the collapse of morale, the collapse in numbers of farming, while retailing rides on into the sunset.
Critics claim that supermarkets have Britain's farmers by the short and curlies. One example is the special promotions they use to entice us into their stores.
Tesco, buy one, get one free. It's simple. You buy one and get one free.
Everyone likes something for nothing, and this commercial appeals to the consumer's mercenary side.
Tesco, every little helps.
But it certainly doesn't help Clive Baxter.
We suffer quite a bit when they do their promotions, or when we're asked to do promotions with them, particularly the buy one, get one free. That hurts us very hard.
Now, how does that hurt you? Because if I go in, I'm a big fan of buy one, get one free. I always see things like that and buy it. But I always think that the supermarket's taking the hit for that. So that's not the case.
No, that's definitely not the case. Last year, because we were doing so much of the raspberries at half price or bog off, that cost me 50,000 pounds. And it is extremely difficult to run a business like that. And we just go from periods of euphoria to periods of despair.
It's not all negative. Clive says supermarkets have helped him become more efficient and produce better quality fruit. But he's totally dependent on them.
What worries me about our relationships with these very powerful people is that we are little ants underneath this great elephant, and we are going to get squashed.
While fruit farmers like Clive Baxter are worried, dairy farming is in crisis. Milk, one of the healthiest of all drinks. In supermarket jargon, it's a known value item. If the price is low, shoppers flock into the store. But the low price of milk has been disastrous for Britain's dairy farmers. In the last 3 years, 3,964 of them have gone to the wall. That's 25 every week. Many of them blame the supermarkets.
Perhaps the most obscene element of all is the supermarkets are prepared to charge as much as or twice as much for a bottle of fizzy water as they are for a bottle of milk. And we, the consumers, buy it.
And it's not just farmers who suffer. John Webster is Professor of Animal Husbandry at Bristol University, and he's worried. Modern dairy farming is becoming an intensive industry, and an increasing number of cows now spend most of their lives indoors. It's called zero grazing. This footage was shot by Compassion in World Farming at two intensive dairy farms in England. Instead of grass, the cows stand on concrete. And instead of grazing in meadows, they are fed mown grass indoors.
They don't have the satisfaction of grazing. They don't have the comfort of being at grass, of lying out in the sunshine or under the tree if it's shady. There's precious little joy in life left for the modern dairy cow. These are having quite a good time.
To produce maximum milk yields, modern dairy cows are pushed to their physiological limits through a combination of selective breeding and high-energy feeds. The impact on cows' welfare has been dramatic. Most supermarket milk is produced under the National Dairy Farm Assurance Scheme, which guarantees high standards of animal welfare. But although not evident at these farms, up to 40% of modern dairy cows suffer from mastitis, a painful inflammation of the udder, which can lead to diarrhea, dehydration, and death. And even more suffer from lameness, caused by standing in slurry.
Lameness in the dairy cow is my biggest worry, because national statistics show that in any one year about 50% of dairy cows are going to become lame, and at any one time over 20% of them are actually in pain from lameness, moderate to severe pain from lameness. Moreover, the pain goes on and on and on for weeks. Food from animals comes from sentient creatures who have the capacity to suffer and who deserve a good life. And that means that when we look for quality in the supermarket, we must build in quality of life for the animal as part of the criteria.
And consumers are losing out too. While supermarket milk is still an essential source of calcium, several recent studies indicate that organic milk is higher in other vital nutrients.
It's got more omega-3, and we're on average getting not even a third of what we should be having. It's got more vitamin E, which helps protect against aging. It's also got more beta-carotene and antioxidants, which protect against cancer and deterioration of the eyesight. It also tastes better, so it's more enjoyable, and actually it doesn't really cost a lot more. We're talking about a few pence difference to have something that is so good and more enjoyable.
So the next time you go to your local supermarket, spare a thought for the poor, overworked dairy cow and consider the quality of the milk you buy. The supermarkets say they have increased the range and diversity of our food, and that's undoubtedly true.
You can eat Mexican, Chinese, you can have guacamole, you can have tortillas, whatever you want. British supermarkets give you it, and we mistake that with appreciating good food at a fundamental level. We don't.
They've turned themselves into cathedrals of choice. You walk past hundreds of metres of products, all demanding, calling for your attention, saying, buy me, eat me, consume me.
Today, supermarkets stock all sorts of exotic fruit and vegetables. Figs, mangoes, aubergines, virtually unavailable 30 years ago. But what about our own homegrown produce? This is the National Fruit Collection in Kent.
You know, it's mystifying. There are more than 700 varieties of apple that are native to the British Isles. Just look at them all. And they've all got fantastic names, as things like Pitmarston, pineapple, green custard, bloody ploughman's, to name but three. Just imagine all that taste and texture, all that choice. So why is it when I go to the supermarket, even during the English apple season, all I see are the same old names?
Most of us don't even know what we're missing. How many varieties of apples can you name?
I don't know. Bramley apple, Cox, Granny Smith. It's Golden Delicious one?
Yeah. One.
It's Granny Smith one?
Yep.
There's your Coxies. Is it Coxies Pippin? Your French Golden?
Golden Delicious, Granny Smith.
So why is our choice so limited? This huge depot is one of Sainsbury's regional distribution centres. All the big supermarkets have them, strategically placed around the country. The supermarkets claim to be introducing more local produce, but every day, fleets of lorries pound the motorways, delivering millions of tonnes of food to the stores.
They've got into this mess over 30 years, this huge, complex distribution system where you can buy food at your local supermarket, and it maybe originally was grown by a farmer 20 miles away, but it's trunked up and down motorways before it comes back to you. This is crazy ecological economics, but it happens.
The environmental and social cost of all these food miles is huge, £9 billion a year. It's been estimated that a typical Sunday lunch travels 26,234 miles. Some journeys simply beggar belief. One Scottish farmer told us that his entire crop of sprouts was taken from the field to a depot, then to an airport where it was flown to Poland to be trimmed and packed, then flown back to the UK and sent to various regional distribution centres. Some of them even ended up at the local supermarket just yards down the road from his farm. And it's the ability to withstand all this travelling and arrive in the supermarket looking perfect that determines what's available. Because some varieties simply get travel sick. Take strawberries, for example. Once a longed-for summertime treat, ripe, soft and dripping with juice,
Now they're available all year round. This is Perry Court Farm Shop in Kent. Now, look, you don't see this in the supermarket. Picked this morning.
No, well, exactly.
Can I eat one?
Of course you can.
Thank you. Mmm. They do taste like... They taste like I remember strawberries tasted. Yeah. Heidi and Martin Furmore used to supply the supermarkets with strawberries. Not anymore.
We grew, I think, about 10 varieties at the time. Two of them, which we thought were excellent strawberries, but they just didn't want to take them.
Why not? I think that,
they thought, I think, at the time El Santa was the one, and that's the only one they wanted.
In the trade, the El Santa is known as the strawberry that bounces.
So we have a Duff variety that has been picked and mature, and this is why you have these big, crunchy red strawberries that last for quite a long time, surprisingly long time, but just have no flavour.
And it's become ubiquitous in British supermarkets. El Santa. El Santa. Well, it doesn't specify what variety these are, but my guess, El Santa. El Santa. So why is it that we British have such bland, tasteless food, but in Europe it's so scrumptious? I've come to Madrid to find out from someone who really knows. The man who used to run Safeway is now over here in Spain in charge of one of the country's biggest supermarkets. Carlos Criado Perez says we get the food we deserve. So, Carlos, I mean, looking at this, what is the difference between what we're seeing here and what we would see in a British supermarket?
Well, I would say that the first thing that is a big difference is that you're seeing fruits and vegetables by the season. So you're not seeing the same product all through the year. In the UK, you would see a set standard all through the year. The bananas would be there the whole year, the grapes would be there the whole year. You're seeing also, they are not all sitting on the shelves and little soldiers looking all alike. They are much more varied in shape.
They're natural.
They're natural, yes. They have more natural.
Carlos told me that in Spain, supermarket shoppers just won't buy grapes when they're out of season. And the varieties they just won't buy, the Spanish export to us. Tastes different.
The good number of the seedless grapes that you buy and you sell in the UK are made in and planted here. But the Spanish market just simply doesn't take it because it goes for taste.
It seems British taste buds pay for year-round fruit and veg.
I'm absolutely convinced that there is a trade-off between getting, you know, everything looking the same, getting your product in a way that you can transport it very efficiently, making it very attractive and very perfect for the looks of the consumer and the taste. There's no doubt in my mind about that.
The trade-off Carlos was talking about became totally clear when I spotted a basket of weird-looking green tomatoes. Now, this chap here... This is hilarious, because he might win a prize in an unusual vegetable competition.
Yeah.
There's no way he would be on a shelf in a British supermarket. Not that I've seen, anyway.
Well, I would believe you, but it is the best tasty one, and it carries a premium here. And it tastes completely different.
Mmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
This is more in keeping with the ones we're used to, the sort of big, juicy red one.
Yeah, this is what Spain exports to the UK.
Mmm. That one's much better, the little misshapen chappy.
Yeah, yeah.
Unlike the British, the Spanish still buy most of their fresh produce from markets. So what would Madrid shoppers think of our perfect-looking UK supermarket fruit?
Pues le falta sabor total.
Bueno, más o menos. Un poco ácida.
pues yo los he consumido aquí y son un poquito más dulce, con más sabor.
Este tomate es insípido para mí.
No me gusta. No son dulces. Muy buena presencia, pero no saben a nada.
No vale nada.
So I'm beginning to understand the difference between supermarkets across Europe and those back home in the UK. People here shop differently. They like to touch their food, they like to smell it, and they certainly like it to have taste. Plus, they know what's in season. Back home, we don't seem to know or care about any of that. So what happens is that our supermarkets are able to sell us what suits them, what suits their system. It seems that all they need to do to get us to buy things is to just make sure that it looks perfect. Next, more supermarket secrets. What's in your kids' packed lunch? And the myth of cheap supermarket produce. Supermarkets like to claim credit for the fact that on average we're spending much less on our food than we used to.
That's to do with all of us, you know, the whole society getting more affluent. It's not true for the people on the lowest incomes. They still spend just as much on food. And I think this is a great myth. Supermarkets haven't given us cheap quality food. They've given us some foods at a loss, which are fantastically cheap, but it's very expensive to eat well now.
Supermarkets might keep the price of known value items like white bread and milk artificially low, but what about fresh produce?
Well, I'm off to my not-so-local greengrocers now, hence the car. When I was a kid, my mum had quite a range of local shops to choose from, but for most of us, that's very much a thing of the past. And it's a popular perception that if you buy your fruit and veg in the supermarket, it's going to be a lot cheaper than if you do manage to find a local provider. So I thought I'd put that to the test.
Look, how fresh is that? It's still got the soil on it. Never see that in the supermarket. Strawberries. I wonder if they're El Santa. I made sure I was comparing like with like by buying the same quantities of similar quality supermarket fruit and vegetables. Okay, so this is the shop that I did this morning at my little not-so-local greengrocer's. Then I went to the three supermarkets that are nearest to my house. That's Tesco, Sainsbury's and Asda. What about the prices? Well, the supermarkets all came out very, very similar in price. Of course, they're locked in price wars, so they keep a sharp eye on this. But here's Tesco's. That was the cheapest at £7.30. Then we had Asda at £7.59. Then Sainsbury's was slightly more expensive at £7.63. So what about my local greengrocer? Well, a lot of people we spoke to said that they shop at supermarkets because they say that they're cheaper. Well, £6.61 at my local greengrocer. So proof, if you need it, that today this was the cheapest. If fresh supermarket produce isn't cheap, prepared fruit and vegetables are downright expensive.
Things the supermarket love is added value, which is where you take something that's really essentially a very simple product for which you can't charge very much and do something to it in order to be able to charge much more. So the classic example is the bag of salad.
Salad. To save you time, we pick it, trim it, wash it, mix it, and pack it. In fact, all you have to do is pop it and take it off the shelf.
This advert appeals to our lazy side.
Every little helps.
And it works. Bagged salads exploded onto the market in 1992. Now over 60% of us buy them regularly. And boy, have they been a nice little earner for the supermarkets. I've just bought this bag of prepared iceberg lettuce from Asda. And at the same time, I bought this whole iceberg lettuce. Now, the one in the bag cost me 66 pence for 200 grams, whereas the whole one cost me 58 pence for 512 grams. That's a 300% markup by Asda. Still, look on the bright side. It must have saved me, at least 30 seconds. And there's another thing. There's more in some salad bags than just bagged salad. Inside, there's a special cocktail of gases, which prolongs its shelf life by up to 10 days. It's called modified atmosphere packaging.
And the whole idea is to slow down that living process, or really to slow down the process of deterioration. Once they're opened, of course, they then have a very short shelf life, because suddenly the processes that we've slowed down in this modified atmosphere suddenly all kick in again, and very quickly.
Maybe that explains why I'm constantly chucking away bags of ready-washed salad that seem to go manky in the blink of an eye. All over Britain, we parents worry about what we're feeding our kids. Experts tell us they're getting fatter and fatter, and more children are being diagnosed with diet-related illnesses, like type 2 diabetes. Ever since Jamie Oliver told us about some of the rubbish that can be found in school dinners, parents up and down the country have been preparing packed lunches for their children. They want them to have simple, nutritious food. But take a look at this lot. Let's start with this drink. It's from the Sainsbury's Blue Parrot Cafe range, and it says on the packaging that it's a range of healthier foods for kids that's been developed with nutritionists. But healthier than what? This orange juice drink, in fact, doesn't have that much orange juice in it, only about 10%, and it has more sugar than a can of Coke. But surely fresh fruit and veg must be really good for children, like this chopped melon, for example, ideal for lunchboxes. Trouble is, recent research by Which magazine has shown that pre-prepared packaged melon like this can lose up to 58% of its vitamin C content. What's more, the supermarkets are making a fortune out of the packed lunch market. You pay through the nose for handy packs like these carrots, which can cost up to 3 times more than if you bought fresh carrots and prepared them yourself. And even those handy little cheeses like this Sainsbury's Red Leicester can end up costing nearly twice as much as cutting and wrapping the cheese yourself. So there you have it. Supermarkets like to give us added value, but who really gains? They say they make our lives easier. But is convenience really worth the cost to our animals, our farmers, our environment, and most of all, our food?
They're not about being great grocers or supplying us with good food or supporting British agriculture or being nice to turkeys or helping working mothers find good food for their children. That's not really what they're about. What they're about is making money, and they do that ruthlessly and very effectively.
40 years ago, shopping was a time-consuming business, but shoppers knew what to look for and what it was worth. Today, the supermarkets want us to think that they do all of that for us, on our behalf. Personally, I think it's high time we relearned some of those old shopping skills.
Gillian McKeith has loads of advice on the grub you chew. You are what you eat, Wednesday at 8:30. Next up, the people with extreme obsessive-compulsive disorders. Will treating them together in the same house cure them of their obsessions?